I didn't know it. It's a new vulnerability that was discovered fairly recently and made public last week, and people are scurrying about trying to understand it and trying to fix it. So that's what I want to talk about. Yes, so a little bit of history. This was discovered in the middle of 2017. Various projects discovered it. And it was announced, actually, just this last week, although it was made available to vendors back in November so that people can start fixing things. And this is standard practice. If you discover a terrible security problem, you let the vendors know, you give them a chance to fix it. And then when it looks like you can't keep the cat in the bag any longer, you can't keep the box, the lid on the box, then you announce it. There are some original papers you can get from that website there, and I've got copies of them myself, and that's how I learned about this. It's one basic architectural flaw and different ways of exploiting it. There is a U.S. CERT, I forget what that stands for, Rapid Dissemination of Security Problems, that's what it stands for. There is an alert saying, we don't have a solution, but here's some guidance. And it is very likely the National Security Agency knew about this and has been using it, but they won't admit to it. So I've got to give you some background, and then I'll get to what the bug is. And so the background, I'll tell you a little bit about page tables in Linux, which this seems to have turned off, which is fine with me. I'll just speak louder. So Linux and Windows, they use a scheme called paging. And modern computers have done this since 1967. You all remember the IBM 360 67, right? Anyway, it introduced this concept. And the idea is that as a program is using a memory address, it gets mapped into some other memory address. And this sounds like a crazy idea, but it turns out to be a very valuable idea. And it's called memory mapping. And in Linux, the way this works, on a 32-bit machine, you've got 2 to the 32 possible addresses. That's 4 gig. And so a program can access 4 gig of memory. Very few programs need that much. And so the design in Linux is that the first 3 gig is available to you, and the last 1 gig is not. But that's a lot of space. The kernel uses that. In fact, all of the kernel and all of its data structures are in that last 1 gig. And it's mapped into your address space. Now that sounds like a terrible idea. That means you can see the kernel. Well, in fact, you can't. Although it's mapped into your address space, the permission bits are turned off. So even though it's there, you have no access rights. You cannot read it, you cannot write it. Why do they do that? So that if your program asks for assistance from the kernel, and it does that regularly in order to read a file, for example, in order to ask for the time of day, any system call, which goes across the boundary, now the kernel is running on your behalf, the kernel then has access to that extra space and can start running without having to change the memory map at all. The memory map doesn't change as you switch into the kernel or out of the kernel. That's a good idea. It saves time. And that's why it's done this way. And I've indicated here, it's the top 1 gig out of 4 gig. On the 64-bit machine, it's actually half of the full address space. On a 64-bit machine, only 48 bits are used for addressing. That's still plenty. 48 bits gives you 256 terabytes. No one's going to need that much. Well, a full half of that is available to the kernel, and it's the top half. So the top half of your virtual space is not visible to you, but it is visible to the kernel. But it can only be read by the kernel. And especially on the 64-bit machine, the kernel uses a small amount of it for its own code, but it also maps all of physical memory into it. You've got lots of room. You've got 128 terabytes. You can certainly map 8 gigabytes into that somewhere, which is the physical memory. So the physical memory is actually visible to the kernel in an easy way. Likewise, it's in every process's address space in an invisible fashion.
And the reason for that, as I mentioned here, is it makes the context switch avoid having to switch to a different page table. If you don't have to switch to a different page table, you don't have to flush things in the translation look-aside buffer, which is a kind of cache for the page table, known by everyone as the TLB. It's a kind of cache. It turns out that flushing is slow, although you wouldn't expect that to be the case. Flushing, that getting rid of the entries in the TLB is slow, and then once it's flushed, reloading it is expensive. So the purpose of this is speed. All of these problems come from the desire for speed. If we were willing to live slowly, we have no problems. But for speed, this is a design decision. And what happens if you try, as an ordinary process, to access the memory that you're not supposed to? It traps. The kernel takes over and says, well, you weren't supposed to do that. And it takes whatever evasive action it is programmed to do. Typically, what it does is it terminates the process. And you get what's called a SIGSEGV, which is an ancient name for a segmentation fault, which is an ancient name for a memory map problem. So that's what happens if you accidentally or intentionally look at memory that you're not supposed to. Right. That's the first part of the background. Here's the second part of the background. Speculative execution of transient instructions. Firstly, speculative execution in general. If you've got a bunch of instructions, you expect that the first one's executed, then the next one, then the next one. That's not what happens in modern processors. Instead, any of the next few instructions that could run now runs, if it doesn't depend on any others. And that keeps more of the CPU involved and makes things faster. So again, it's speed that kills us here. Because the CPUs actually, they pipeline and they read ahead, they're going to be speculating as to whether this instruction is really needed or not. Usually it is, and by the time you need it, it's been done. Sometimes it's not needed. When would that be? Well, it could be that there's a branch, a conditional branch. Here are your instructions. There's a branch, but it's conditional. If zero, go there. Otherwise, keep going. Well, what is the poor CPU to do? You could say, I'm just not going to do any more speculation. But in fact, modern CPUs guess which way you're going to go, that way or this way. And then it'll start executing instructions on the side that it guesses. Now, if it turns out that it guessed wrong, no problem. It never finishes those instructions. It does them. But any results, it discards. So if there's an instruction saying, put a 3 into a register, it pseudo does that. But if it decides that it didn't need to, then it doesn't change the register after all. What if one of those instructions that it is speculating about is an instruction that it's going to trap because it accesses invalid memory? It doesn't actually trap until we decide, yes, this instruction is one that we want to do. As long as it's speculative, it doesn't yet trap. And in fact, the instructions after it might also be speculated and done. But finally, when we decide, are we going to go that way or this way, and we decide to go the way that was going to trap, then the trap happens, and the things after it get discarded. So it's a complicated business inside the computer, inside the CPU. Modern CPUs do this. They speculate as to which way you're going to go. They work in advance of what they need, and they're willing to throw stuff out that wasn't needed, just to discard results. So, if an instruction causes a trap, or the branch prediction is wrong, the stuff after the failure might have already been evaluated, but it doesn't have any effect. Any effect that it might have had is reverted. Any uncommitted results are not available, except, we'll get to the except soon. They're not visible at the architectural level. There's a different lower level called the microarchitectural level, but that's a different level. You cannot see any effect in the registers, you cannot see any effect in the memory of transient instructions that get reverted. And that's intentional, of course. Now, there are various ways that a program can avoid dying if it makes an invalid memory reference. Method one is, the reason we need this is because the kind of attacks I'm going to be describing do this. they try to avoid dying when they make an invalid memory reference. So, in fact, Meltdown uses the first two, and Spectre uses the third way of avoiding a trap. So, number one, you can arrange by talking to the operating system, saying, if I do a segmentation violation, don't kill me, just let me know that I've done it, and I'll take care of it myself. I'll maybe just ignore it, or I'll print a message, but don't kill me, please. This is possible in Unix. And it's possible in Windows. And it slows things down, because every time you generate a trap, it goes to the kernel. The kernel says, well, I'm going to kill you. Nah, I guess you've arranged to handle this yourself. You get to handle it. When you're finished handling it, comes back to the kernel, comes back to the process. It takes a while, but it does avoid terminating the process. So Meltdown can use this, although it's a pretty slow method. They prefer to use something else if something else is available. That's number two, Meltdown. Some architectures have an instruction, some of the more recent Intel chips. It's the TSX instruction, which stands for transaction. And you know from databases that if you start a transaction and something goes wrong or you choose not to complete the transaction, you can back out of it without any of the actions in that period taking any effect after all. The same thing can be done with modern CPUs. You start a transaction, you do some instructions, and you close the transaction. If during that period you generated a trap, but you abort the transaction instead of completing it, the trap doesn't happen. And so Meltdown will use that if the CPU is a modern CPU that happens to have that instruction. Now the third way of doing this is to place the invalid access instruction on a branch that you are sure, or you can try to be sure, that the CPU is going to speculate that's the one you're going to take. But then after all, you take a different branch. It is possible to arrange for the branch target buffer, which is how these CPUs figure out which way you're going to go. They look at the history. How often have you gone this way? How often have you gone this way? But you can poison that. You can force it to make the wrong decision. Now, even in someone else's program, if you know where the branch instruction, where the target is, it turns out that the target is not important. It's the lowest 20 bits of the target that are important. So within your own address space, you can play with branch instructions that go to an address which is the same in the lower 20 bits. And you can prime this translation technique, branch target buffer, to make the wrong decision. And so finally, when it does speculate, you know it will speculate in a direction that will not be taken. Although, it speculates. In fact, this will generate a trap. Your speculative stuff generates a trap, but that's okay, because it'll never actually trap, because it's the one not taken. All right. It's the one that's speculated towards, but in fact, finally is not used. Now I've got to tell you about cache lines, and all these pieces that come together. Memory is slow. As I get older, my memory gets slower and slower. And as, no, actually, much, much worse, I'm sorry to say. Modern CPUs work at a very high clock rate in the gigahertz. It takes on the order of a microsecond, or a little bit less these days, to get to memory. That's much too slow. And so inside the CPU chip is a place to store things that have been recently accessed in memory. And we call that a cache. In fact, the cache is in several levels. There's the one, inside one chip you might have four CPUs. Each of them has its own cache. The whole chip has a cache. And the board onto which you stick it has a cache. And then there's memory. And so there's these various levels of cache. And they're arranged in such a way that if you do access memory, the thing you've gotten from memory is stored in these various levels. And the next time you need that same address, with luck, you'll get it at one of the closed levels and you won't have to go to memory. So in fact, the CPU tries simultaneously, is it in the cache? Is it in memory? And if it turns out that the cache has the answer, it forgets about asking the memory, it interrupts that one, and it just uses the cache. This is important for making things run fast. Again, speed is our enemy. So that's, all computers these days have caches. It's in order to make things run fast enough. And in the usual running of things, the cache hits are extremely high. You'll get 95% or higher cache hit rate. Very seldom do you actually have to go to memory. You almost always can get things from the cache. Now, so caches are at multiple levels. The last level cache, that's the one that's the farthest out. All the CPUs share the same highest level cache. We'll call it the LLC, which stands for Limited Liability Company. And there's only so many TLAs you can build, three-letter acronyms. All right. So the address of the memory you're trying to access determines which cache cell, and a cache cell is actually considered a line, because it usually holds more than one byte. It holds 128 bytes or something of memory. As long as you're picking up one thing of memory, you might as well pick up the ones nearby. Chances are you're going to need them too, so the whole bunch of local of similar memories loaded into the cache. So if you've got two addresses which are separated by the length of a cache line, they're certainly going to be put into different cache lines. In fact, if you separate by even more thing, like a whole page, 4 kilobytes or 8 kilobytes typically, almost certain it's going to be in a different cache line. All right. And when the cache access succeeds, we call it a cache hit. That's a good thing. Now you understand everything there is to know about caches. The first kind of attack, called a cache side channel attack. Well, a cache hit makes access faster, right? So you can measure access times, and you can tell whether the cache has a hit or not if you've got a high accuracy, a high precision clock. And so you can walk through a bunch of cache lines, and you can evaluate how long it took to access each piece of memory. And if it was quick, it was in the cache. If it's slow, it was not in the cache. By itself, that doesn't sound dangerous. But we're going to use something called, Meltdown Inspector used something called a flush and reload attack, which was first described in 2014 by Yadom and Faulkner. It's called flush and reload. The idea is that I've got a process which is doing nothing but flushing a bunch of cache lines. That means make sure that the information in those lines is not in the cache, and then reading them, and then timing each of those. And if any of those is short, as opposed to a long reference, that means that meanwhile, someone loaded that cache line. I can tell if someone else is loading a cache line by measuring how long it takes. And it turns out this is pretty effective. And even though I'm in one process and this other guy's in another process, still, we're sharing the same cache. Even if I'm on one CPU and the other one's on a different CPU, it's the highest level cache. I can tell if something's in the cache in one of these shared cache lines. Now, the fact that someone else put something in the cache line doesn't give me permission to read it, but I am able to see that the cache line is full. All right, so now I have almost all the pieces. Here's the bug. Abandoned transient instructions modify the cache. Everything that they do, if I abandon that set of speculative instructions, is discarded, except for the fact that it might have loaded the cache. The cache is not unloaded automatically. It's still there. And it would be kind of hard at the microarchitectural level to make sure that if you loaded the cache, you then unload it, because it was speculative. So that event remains, all right? So the memory read instruction might fail because of a permission violation. I can try to read off of kernel memory, which is in the high part of my memory. That will certainly fail. However, it might leave an indication in the cache, because it temporarily succeeded until it was abandoned. And then I got the trap, and I avoided the trap by one of the methods that I showed. Unfortunately, the permission check to see whether I am allowed to look at that memory happens well after the fact that the memory has actually been accessed and put in the cache. Therefore, something can be put in a cache even though I don't have permission to see it. And in fact, a few instructions following the invalid access might also happen and might also leave stuff in the cache. The results are discarded, the cache update remains. So here is the assembler for Meltdown. Now it's written in Intel assembler. If all you know is GNU assembler, you've got to change the way you look at things. But I'll read you this. We're going to start with a C register, which is called RCX. The C register will hold an address that I'm not supposed to look at in the kernel. The B register will be pointing to an array that I built. And the array is pretty large, 256 times 4 kilobytes, right? And at the beginning, no part of the probe array will be cached, and I'll make sure that it's not cached. Then I will move, this is the source, that's the destination. I'll move whatever the RCX is pointing to, it's pointing to something I'm not supposed to look at. I'll move that byte into the A register. AL means the lowest piece of the A register. This will generate a trap. So what? The next instructions are being done anyhow. Then I will take the result of that and I'll shift it left by 12. That's multiplying it by a page size. So now I have, speculatively, a value which is 4k times a value I wasn't supposed to see, a one byte thing. Then, forget the jump zero, I will then look at my array. And I'll only look at the point which is pointed to by this byte as shifted. I'll try to read that. If that succeeds, it's all going to be thrown away. But if that succeeds, it loads the cache. Someone else now can be watching the cache and can see by walking through this array, this probe array, which one of those was actually modified. This thing about jump zero retry, they said when they experimented with this, they discovered that they got zeros more often than not, even if the value wasn't zero. And this is a way of trying to force it to actually not give them a zero. I won't go into the details there. So meanwhile, someone else is iterating over all the pages of the probe array and measuring access time. And we put all of this within a device that prevents a trap. Preferably the TSX instruction. Now, what's slow about this, it turns out the flush and reload attack over 256 separate places is the bottleneck. They said, okay, we'll reduce it to one bit. We'll only try to read instead of a whole byte at a time. We'll just look at one bit at a time. Then we only have to check two cache lines, not 256 of them. Turns out that was much faster. There are randomizations which stand in the way, but they were able to get around that. And so the effect was they were able to read kernel memory. Memory you're not supposed to read, a byte at a time. And in fact, if they were able to use the TSX, they were able to read at a pretty high rate, 500 kilobytes per second, with a very low error rate. They figured that out by looking at some known content. If they didn't have TSX, they had to do exception handling, it went down to about one-third that speed. That's still a respectable speed for reading through kernel memory. They can find anything in the kernel. And the kernel has got all of memory with that map, including the contents of other people's code. I'm running this while you're running Firefox. I can look inside of your Firefox. Your Firefox has got some passwords stored in it. I can see them. That's the problem. Their toy example worked on the ARM and the AMD processors, but they couldn't get the actual exploit to work. We should all go out and buy stock in AMD and ARM. The idea should work, but the actual implementation, they couldn't get it to work. Well, this can be fixed, but not very well in the software. One thing is, at the operating system level, don't use a page table that maps the kernel. Use a different page table. Just yesterday, Ubuntu released such kernels, and people who are running shared machines like cloud servers, which are running multiple within one server, running multiple competing people, running their stuff, they're starting to use this immediately. There's a patch known as Kaiser, kernel address isolation mishap, China, well, they They thought Kaiser first, and they invented the acronym. This does solve the problem, but it slows things down. Up to a 30% slowdown, although typically they're standard examples, they found about 5% slowdown because going in and out of the kernel is slower because you've got to do page table stuff. Yesterday, a new version of Firefox came out. And what they did is the same problem can be done by JavaScript. When you have JavaScript running in your browser, that's compiled into instructions. Those instructions can do this. And they tried to prevent that by turning off two things. One is they reduced from 5 microseconds to 20 microseconds the precision of the clock. So it's harder to measure the time of the cache usage. And also, they disabled the shared array buffer, which is this big buffer you're going to use to hold on to the cache hits. And Internet Explorer, Edge, Chrome, they've all done the same sort of thing. Yeah, Luke?
How does disabling features in Firefox make Firefox safer?
Oh, it means that people cannot exploit this from inside of Firefox. It does not mean that people outside of Firefox can't read inside of Firefox.
Oh.
But it means that people can't put on a web page a bit of JavaScript which releases information from inside your browser and from inside your entire computer back to the owner of the web page.
Okay.
So, this changing the position of the code.
Yes.
Does it really fix things absolutely or only?
Relatively, but I think that they chose this to be still usable, but enough to break the cache. This cache attack requires pretty careful timing. So apparently that was enough. Now the hardware fix is, well, you could disable automated execution. No one wants to do that. You've got to be able to do that if you want speed. Another is, do the permission check first, and then register, but no one wants to do that. Another is, a nice idea, but it requires a new architecture. It says, have a new register in the CPU that says, if this is turned on, no ordinary process is allowed to use any address at the top half. You can tell if the address is in the top half, the top bit is on. All that, and you can check that really quickly without going to any page tables. So my guess is within a year we'll start seeing processors that have that new register. I've got very little time to tell you about Spectre, but you learn all about return-oriented programming attacks in CS270, which you should all take. The idea is, if you know a program that you want to attack, and you can find little code snippets in it, you can, with a buffer overflow, cause those little code snippets to be run. And you can try to assemble them into an attack. And so, these code segments are called gadgets. And if you can put arbitrary data on the stack, which itself requires a buffer overflow attack, then, as a consequence of that, you can put things together which do the same sorts of things that Meltdown did. Address space layout randomization makes it harder, but not impossible, it turns out. So that's what Spectre does. I'm not going to go into the details. The notes will be available online. Software, it turns out that, look at the last point here. The attack is extremely difficult to accomplish. No one has actually built a working Spectre attack against anything. And it will only divulge data within the user's process itself. So if someone is able to cause your program to misbehave, then that malefactor can read other things in your memory. Okay, last slide. What you should do, don't panic. Of course, keep your software up to date, and don't put secrets in software on shared computers, right? So don't put passwords into financially important passwords into your Firefox browser as to be stored if you're on a shared computer until this fix is out. Right? So there it is, the newest and best of the attacks. And it's going to be a while before this is properly fixed. That's it.